Sunday, the day of rest. Now, in a Blue Peter style, why don't you get some sticky back plastic, attach your tush to the sofa, and let me do the rest. Aye, aye, check out the bunch of dream boats bobbing about on my sofa today. Look at them. She eats politicians for breakfast before we've even knocked up a smoothie. It's Good Morning Britain reporter Ranvir Singh.
Yay!
His one-day book is so popular, it's against government regulation not to have read it. Top author David Nicholls is here. She's the songbird who comes with a health warning. To any gentleman watching, don't look directly into her eyes because you could be in danger of actually melting. It's Louise! Cute double act, missus.
Hell yeah.
Plus, if your weekend plans are looking as tempting as a sea cucumber cocktail, do not panic. Let us intoxicate you with cool stuff to do and brilliant books. We've got to get the conversation wheels a-rolling with a little nugget of knowledge now. Catch, Ranvir. Beautiful. Really. Just have to mime it.
Yeah, sorry.
She's very new.
I feel in fact.
On this day in 1961, Barack Obama was born. He was, of course, the 44th president of the United States. But before that, and we miss him, don't we? We miss him. We miss his lovely face. But before that, his very first job was as an ice cream scooper, did you know? Let's talk jobs. Louise. I was going to say, what's your first job? Was it being a pop star?
Well, it was my first proper job. Yeah, but I did get
Hang
a job.
On. That's not a proper job, babe.
No, that's not a proper job. I actually got a job in a sock shop in Victoria Station. Can you remember the sock shop?
Yeah. Yeah.
I loved a pair of socks, but I only did it once and then I didn't really like it. So I didn't go back.
David, have you had interesting, weird, wonderful jobs?
I was a pop star. No, I was I worked in a petrol station opposite Southampton Airport, yeah.
Excellent.
I used to do the night shifts. I mean, I was way too young to be doing it. It was a big responsibility, all that petrol flying around and me at 16 or 17 or something. I don't know how I got the job, but...
It was before health and safety went, yeah. Like, actually, what about you, Ranvir? What about
I think my first one was popcorn popping in a popcorn factory.
Oh, wow.
It was quite good fun, actually. It was. It was like you had all these 18 vats of oil, boiling hot oil. You had to get, like, a perfect scoop of these corns. Run up and down, put them in, put the sugar in, and then by the time you'd finished the 18th one, the first one was popping, so you go back and bag it all up, and you got loads of free popcorn at the end of the day.
It sounds like a fantasy kids job.
Yes, what do you want to do? What do you want for popcorn?
That's more interesting than pop star.
Yeah, yeah,
definitely.
It was good. It was good.
That's really good. It's a real kind of like, I want to work in a popcorn factory. It actually exists.
It exists.
So, Ranvir, you've been covering politics for 5 years now at Good Morning Britain, or should I say, the award-winning Good Morning Britain top news team.
Well, I'll let you say it.
It's not changed, though, has it, babe? It's not changed yet.
Not really.
Congratulations. Tell us about the award.
It was actually appropriately called the Golden Nymph. Ooh. Don't know where they got that from.
Yes.
Anyway, I'm happy to take the title. The Golden Nymph Award. So it's in Monaco. I mean, of all places, it could have been anywhere in the world. But we had to go to Monaco to go and pick it up. It was such a shame.
Come on, tell me you were
really
partying on, like, a Playboy's yacht, all that sort of stuff
going
on.
It was incredible.
Yes.
Will from Will and Grace was sat there. I love Will and Grace. I was, like, proper fangirling. And then we went on stage. We didn't know we were going to win, by the way. So when they said our name, and we thought that we were up against CNN and Al Jazeera and all these, like, world sort of 24-hour news operations. And the award was for live breaking news event. And there was the Genoa Bridge collapse and there was all these other things. So we were all convinced that CNN were going to win because they're kind of, you know what I mean? It's like you're up against the big
boys. So were you getting your face ready?
Oh, completely. completely. Actually, we were just like, we haven't won, we never win anything. And then they went, and we're like, good morning. And then we went up and Michael Douglas was there. On stage.
In fact, I know
amazing.
This. So he was he given out the award?
He was given a Lifetime Achievement
Fine.
Award. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Because we've got a picture. What I love about you is that you always keep your sort of journalist head on. You're very sensible. And we can see that in this photograph of you with Michael Douglas now.
Yeah.
We just... Hang on a minute. What are you doing to the Hollywood legend?
Oh, God. It was just... So that guy next to Michael Douglas is our director. He looks schmoozing. Can you see? He's got in the shot. He knows exactly
yes.
what he's doing. Michael, could we have a selfie? Just photobombing in the back is our editor. And
okay.
then I'm being the proper team player. I'm saying to the rest of the team, look who's here. It's Michael Douglas in the meantime, poking his eye out. Go and get in the shot, everybody.
It looks like you're about to give him a wet willy. You know, when you're going like that in his ear. Like, don't wet willy Michael Douglas. What are you thinking?
This is as close as I got to getting a picture with an A-list celebrity.
It
was an epic fail. Epic fail.
Well done. Now, you're often loitering around Downing Street as part of your job. Are they nice to you there when the weather turns? Do they bring you a brew, some biscuits?
Never.
No?
There is nowhere to go for a wee. It is the worst place in the... It's colder than anywhere at Downing Street. You go down the microclimate, it is always dark, dingy and a bit miserable down there. Not even joking.
It's a bit apocalyptic.
Yeah, it is, really.
It's got its own weather system.
It has, yes, exactly. Like, I don't know whether they just do it for, just for the journalists. Like, they make it really inhospitable so you leave. But the security guard, like, the security personnel down there, I know them quite well
now. I was going to say, because there's all the police down there.
Yeah, exactly. And so you get to know them over the years and you have a bit of banter and then they tell me what they think of their potential new boss who's coming into number 10 and what they, you know, and cuts and all that. So
have a little gossip.
Yeah,
right.
It's good.
We've got another picture of you here, obviously being incredibly professional. Can you talk us through exactly... Let's not tell Louise and David what's happening here. Can you spot anything unusual in this picture here of Ranvir? Have a look.
Oh, slippers. Oh, I love it.
Louise, you were right. I bet you're...
Oh, yeah, I'm right on it.
I bet you're really...
Yeah.
I bet you're all over spot the difference in a puzzle book. Yeah. She's
like... I'm actually really good at that.
So, talk us through what happened there, Michael.
So, it was the end of a very long week. So, you know, I work, I get up at 3:20 in the morning.
Can we just have a oof for that, please? Wow. Oof.
I've been doing that for, like, 7 years non-stop.
You're looking great on it. You look like you're 18.
Thanks very much.
How do you do it?
Your eyesight's terrible, by the way. Work on that later. I work sometimes, so sometimes I do evening news. So, that particular week, I've been getting up at 3:20, doing my job, and then I'd been doing news at 10, so literally getting 3-4 hours sleep a night. So this was the Friday, and I'd been staying in a hotel in London, and I was so tired. You know what it's like, you can't wear heels last day of the week. I cannot wear heels again. So I got out the hotel, wet hair, hotel stuff. So I'll just drag myself into work, they'll do my hair and makeup when I get in. Completely forgot to change my shoes. Went into the studio with my slippers on, and then as they're doing the opening, and I saw the camera, I thought, oh my God, I've got my slippers on, I'm reading the news with my slippers on. So I was trying to hide my feet as they're doing it.
Oh my gosh, I love it, because you would have walked past perhaps 15 people. Cameramen, you know, the floor manager, makeup, hair, all of that, and nobody
said.
Eat, Shop, Save, ITV hit show, third series, congrats.
Yes, thank you very much.
Very nice. So tell us a little bit about it.
So we have 4 families in each series, and they apply because, as I have often felt, that everything's okay, you know, nothing's too bad in your life, you're sort of getting on with it all, but you're really quite tired, and you know, your relationship is fine, but you've both put on a bit of weight, but neither of you can really say anything to each other. And so basically it's people who are, their spending is slightly out of control, they've got household debt, they're finding it hard to save, they're putting on weight. The kids are a bit worried. You know, it's just all of that stuff. It's not extremes. We used to see a lot of extremes on TV, but this is kind of every family in the country who is working hard, a bit tired, and can't seem to get a grip on getting healthier.
And you sort of swoop in there and just help them. Let's have a little clip there. This is the Vasta family.
Vix, Dad passed away quite young. I always say to him, well, your dad was really healthy and he passed away at 48, so you have to be really careful. When I had the baby, I said to him, if you're not going to do it for yourself and you're not going to do it for me, you do it for me, hun. You have to do it for him. Was that quite hard to hear?
It's just me.
It just hits home, doesn't it?
Yeah. Well, I have to say you've both been really honest about what the problems are and what you want to change. Do you both feel that you're now in the right position to get it done?
Yeah, definitely.
Oh, it's good. It's good. Now, you're very good when people get upset like that. And I think there's only a few people who can do that, because Davina's very good at that. Louise is fair saying, would you not be any...
I'd be crying straight away. I'd be crying more than them.
Yeah, it's a real skill to be able to talk to people like that. You were motivated yourself, weren't you, making this?
Well, did you not see how different I look now to then? I mean, even I can see it. So... what I was talking to them about was, obviously, Vic's dad having died quite young, and he needed to do it because he had visceral fat around his organs. The stuff you can't see, it's not vanity, actually. You know, there comes a point in your life where you don't, you know, you can dress for your weight, it's fine.
All you care about is that everything works.
Yes, exactly.
To a certain age where
and you look at your kids and you think, I want to be around for them. And so that's what was really emotional about that. And that was amazing for them. They did lose weight, and you'll see it in the show. But what's remarkable is that, so I lost about over a stone during the filming of the show.
Wow.
Because for the same reason, really. So my dad died when I was 9 and he was 42 of a heart attack. So I really empathised with Vic in that story. And I just sat there and I thought, oh, I've got to do something.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Literally, that was like, you practice what you preach.
Well, absolutely. Yeah, yeah.
Oh, well, good for you. Well done. Right, it's that time. Betty's got to join the party. She plays tunes handpicked by our guests and then pops them up on our Spotify playlist. Ranvir, it's your turn. Do the honours.
Betty, play my song.
Oh, I'm going sideways. It's a great tune. And this is one of the best tunes we've put on the Spotify playlist. Thank you very much. Why do you love it so much?
Well, because this is from Miss Education of Lauryn Hill, which when I was 20 was like my favourite, and it's remained my favourite album of all time. Last year, we went on holiday to Miami, and as I was looking around on Twitter and things, I realised she was playing in Miami when we were there, and it was her 20th anniversary tour. So I was like, oh my God, this is fate. I've got to go and see her. Booked it. Cost a fortune. She cancelled.
Oh.
And for a whole year, I have not listened to Lauryn Hill.
Oh.
I've been so upset and so
bitter.
I've been really annoyed. And so today, Sarah, I am rehabilitating myself. I'm forgiving her.
Oh, can we applaud that in an Oprah Winfrey audience? Star, right? Yes. Good for you, you're very brave. All of our guests are going to pile in with their tunes throughout the show. Eat Shop Saves on ITV Thursday night, 8:30. Ranvir Singh, everyone, she's gorgeous. Very good. Quick break time. Maybe do a shout out to your ex if they really are the best. And we'll see you in a spin. More icons on my sofa than in a Bradley Cooper Oscar selfie. Look at them. Ranvir Singh, David Nicholls and Louise. Louise, enjoying that you're Louise now.
I know.
It's really good.
It's
dead good. You are back then. After 16 years, you are doing what you do best, making beautiful music.
Yeah.
Now, this album is out in October. This is what it's going to look like. It's called Heavy Love. So this is it. What was it like to get back into the studio then after quite a big break?
It was weird because I wasn't expecting... I was expecting to not really know what to do. And I think for the first time, I went into the studio and I wrote most of the album. Co-wrote with different people.
Yeah.
And I realised making an album in my 40s to making an album in my 20s was completely different. I had so much more life experience. I had so much I wanted to say. And I don't know, it just felt such a natural process. And I work with great writers, but I think my heart poured out a little bit on this.
Well, you know, we have a lot of people on the show who say that a little bit of heartbreak goes a long way when it comes to writing good songs that people can relate to.
I think so. I think it's how honest you're prepared to be and how you want to say it. But and that the album's really upbeat, actually. I think people are expecting maybe a mid-tempo. It's big, dancey, disco, lots. There's a couple of maybe sadder songs on there, but it's just lyrically quite empowering and just about celebrating who we are.
Good. And you're in a good place, you're happy, you're good.
Yes, yeah. Look, I'm not going to lie. I think everyone knows I've had a tough couple of years, but like all of us, that's what happens, and we fight forward and move on.
Let's have just a quick look at the video then for Lead Me On. Let's have a look at this. Very nice. I like the bit where you've lost your car keys, where you're like,
where are they?
I also spotted a palm tree. I was like, she's not daft. She's got a nice little trip out of that. Yeah. Where did you film it? It looked beautiful.
We actually filmed it in Portugal.
Beautiful.
It was so beautiful. Like, the property that we filmed in was just incredible. It was just a really big sort of dilapidated chateau but nice. Ooh, incredible.
I love
it. It was so gorgeous. Yeah, so that was Portugal, so we got a bit of sun.
And you were doing some of your moves there that, you know, did you get a lot of confidence from doing Strictly? To
absolutely.
Just bust some
moves? Yeah, especially for this type of song. It's real summer. It's kind of got that calypso sort of samba feeling. And before, I'd always been sort of doing the eternal moves or a bit of naked, which is all a little bit more poppy. Yeah. And here, yeah, I could do a little bit of shimmering and,
nice.
You
what is
know,
it? So hip thrusting. Kind of like
yeah, you know,
crop top.
Back in the Running Man, back in the day.
So tell us, you're going on tour with 9to5.
Yes.
I came to see you because we had Bonnie Langford and we had Brian come on the show, Brian
wicked.
Conley. And you were absolutely fantastic. Aww. I mean, does it feel a big deal when you're in a West End show like 9to5? Like, is it nerve-wracking?
Yeah. Do you know, for me, it was a bit of a lifetime ambition. I sort of went to stage school and I fell into the pop industry, which has been amazing and definitely, because I love songwriting and being that kind of muso-y type person in the studio. But there's nothing like performing on a West End stage, and your audiences are not particularly big, but every night, everybody is so... especially a show like 9to5, Dolly Parton. I mean, everyone just wants to come for a good time. And I have to say, I loved it. I really loved it. It was such a dream come true.
And are you going on tour with it when it goes, when it sets off? It's September, isn't it?
Yep, so I did 3 months, and then I've got a couple of months off because the album and school holidays. Yeah. I just want to, you know. And
working mum.
Where it was just tough doing 8 shows a week with 2 boys at home that,
I bet.
You know, school holidays, at least with music, you can kind of sort your scheduling out. And then I go back on the road with 9to5 in September.
Fantastic. And it's going to be Manchester, Milton Keynes, Liverpool, Glasgow, Edinburgh, Dublin. And it is fantastic fun. It's
can you
so
see
good.
I've chosen really fun cities to
Yeah, you've got the best ones, babe. tell us about your jewellery line. Are you working on a jewellery line?
Yeah, I'm quite... I love anything that's sort of design-related, so whether it be interior, fabric, fashion. Mm. And jewellery is kind of my latest thing that I'm really into, but not jewellery as in expensive diamond jewellery, like trinkets, like little pieces that you can almost make. But yeah, so nice. I'm loving doing
it. I bet
that.
Your house is beautiful.
I know.
Ooh,
I just
it's like
that.
Style, like everything. You know, it's just.
I bet it's all muted shades of grey.
It is muted shades of grey. But listen, I've got a 15-year-old who like leaves football. I mean, well, 2 sporty boys. So if anybody has got sweaty football boots at home, they reek.
It's a certain odour stink.
I mean,
it?
Even if I put them in the garage, I feel like they've left an aroma in my home.
No, I won't come round then.
No,
it's
don't
fine.
Come round.
I felt like an invite was on its way.
But you know,
right off now. So that if, like Louise, you fancy tinkering with some trinkets, we've got some jewellery recommendations.
Yes.
What have you got for us there,
so
please, Louise?
So I have got. Okay. So Colchester Castle. The castle is the largest Norman keep in Europe. Originally built in the 11th century, the exhibition shows jewellery from the Bronze Age to modern day bling. You can get in for £10 if you're an adult and £5.25 if you're a child.
Very nice. It's called Jewellery, The Human Story.
Yes.
There's loads of amazing... In fact, we struggle to whittle down how many brilliant jewellery-making workshops there are, so if you Google it, there'll be one right near you. If you're in Birmingham, though, you are in luck. The Quarter Workshop, it's in the historical jewellery quarter, as you'd imagine. Not the butcher. Evening and weekend classes, make bangles, earrings, wedding bands, classes from £55. If you're in Brighton, get yourself down to Posh Totty. It's the largest jewellery workshop in the south of England. Loads of evening classes, jewellery classes from £75. Let's have a look. Oh, this is really sweet as well. If you want to get the kids involved, this is really nice. Junkfish run free kids' workshops at loads of festivals. You can make headdresses, wings and masks. Just go and have a look at their website and check it out. Lovely job. Thank you very much. Louise, you are going to sing for us in just a moment.
Yes.
But we would love you to add a song, please, to our playlist.
OK. So, Betty, will you play my song? 4 months I can
touch, but my heart used to dream of. Pressure on you, David. There's been 2 great songs. So good. Stevie Wonder for Once in My Life. It's beautiful. What's that song mean to you?
Do you know, whenever I listen to Stevie, wonder. I call him like I know him, I don't. I don't know, he makes me smile. And I love the lyrics, and I actually watched him recently in Hyde Park. And he was just incredible. He was one of those artists that my dad would always play when I was growing up. And I have to say, most probably really influenced me in thinking I wanted to be a singer, because I would constantly sing Stevie Wonder songs. Excellent. And old Motown. My dad used to say, it's my record player, you listen to what I'm playing. And at the time, I was like, really? I want what everyone else is listening to. Now I'm slightly grateful, because I think I have a really good musical base of good old school Motown.
Perfect, and we'll pop it on the playlist. It'll sound magnificent. Thank you very much, Louise. Right, time for you to head over and get ready to play. There you go. Through the small dog assault course in those heels, not easy. Yeah, she's ready with her new single, Lead Me On. It's the brilliant Louise. Be singing again for us a little bit later on. Time for a short break, maybe sweep the pantry, not a euphemism, and then we'll be back with brilliant author David Nicholls. We'll see you in a more. Calling today's guests a Google, because they're everything I've been searching for. Ranvir Singh, David Nicholls and Louise are here. Now, then, David. Yes. Brace for some serious stats. Are you ready?
Okay, go on.
8 million books sold worldwide. Published, thank you, published into 40 different languages. And can we talk about this? 5 million books sold of this.
That's
beauty.
Right. Yeah,
one
thank
day.
You.
Now, we have a lot of authors come on this show. Some of them have, like, books piled up to here.
Yeah.
Your pile is small, it's but small. Perfectly formed. And this, I mean, this was absolutely huge, wasn't it?
Yeah. Yes.
Did the idea for one day come to you? Just was it a light bulb moment? Did you think, yes, I'm definitely going to be able to go on a nice holiday next year? When you
I didn't think that, because the book before hadn't done amazingly well, so no one was waiting for the book, and it took me a long time to write, and I knew that it was a, it has a little kind of structural idea. It's a love story, but told on the same day every year for 20 years. Yeah. And I thought, well, that's a good idea. I don't think anyone's done that. And I really loved writing it. And often if you're enjoying the writing, that kind of finds its way onto the page.
Yeah.
But I had no expectation of it taking off in the way it did.
Louise hasn't read one day yet.
So okay. I would no start spoilers. Today.
Would you recommend it's a good starting point in your books?
I think it'll always be the most popular.
Yeah.
And I think I've kind of learnt so much as a writer. I think the two books that come after are better, but I think I will always be known for that book, and I'm very happy with that. I'm very proud of it.
Yeah, gosh, and you really so should I, be. It's an absolute beauty. Your new one then, Sweet Sorrow. I mean, just to look at, I mean, an absolutely beautiful cover. It's so lovely. There's a lot of anticipation about this book.
Yes.
Do you feel the pressure?
I do, yeah. After one day, I couldn't write anything for a long time, and I just sat in this office staring at the wall and thinking, well, how do I do that again? Mm. Do I do something completely different?
Well, you managed to fill your days by just casually winning a BAFTA for writing amazing screenplays. Well, is that right?
It's
Patrick Melrose, congratulations
thank you.
For that.
Yes, yeah. It's nice to be able to jump between the two. And when I'm doing scripts, I always think, I wish they'd let me get on and write a book. And when I'm writing a book, I really want to get back and work with actors and directors and collaborate.
You turn the clock back a little bit, sort of, to try and remember, you know, what it was like to be 16.
Yeah.
How tricky was that? Because the main character's 16.
Yes, I mean, I remember it quite well. I don't really remember being 11 or 12, but 16 is a big change. And the novel is set in the summer after you do your GCSEs, or O-levels in my case. And it's about that long summer where suddenly you feel like an adult with adult responsibilities, and you're desperate for something to happen. And in Sweet Sorrow, the thing that happens to Charlie, the main character, is that he falls in love. So I wanted to write a kind of a classic first love story, a classic summer love story.
Nice. Did you fall in love when you were 16?
No, I was in the petrol station.
Surrounded by car air freshness.
Yeah. Often you write a kind of... I mean, I tend to write two things. I tend to write a kind of, like, a romantic, ideal version, interspersed with kind of catastrophes, with the worst possible thing you can imagine happening. So they're kind of tragicomedies. They're the best and the worst that can happen.
You've set it in 1997.
Yeah.
So Britpop was huge. I mean, it was kind of a big year. Princess Diana died. It was a huge sort of news year, and it just felt like there was a lot of change going on.
Yeah.
How was it sort of researching that? Was it lovely to sort of get stuck into... Because it really... The nostalgia really comes through in the story.
Yes, I mean, I wasn't 16 in 1997.
Well, I thought you had a showbiz age.
So there was a certain amount. I mean, the novel starts with the school disco, and I had to make sure that I knew what would be playing in the school disco in 1997. And there are a few cultural references, but I did worry about it. And then I realised that actually being 16 is universal. You have the same kind of anxieties, whether it's 1983 in my case, or 97 or whatever.
Now, was the top hit from Louise, Let's Go Around Again, playing at the school disco? Because she's going to sing it for us later, and that's from 1997.
Maybe
well,
in
next
the paperback.
Time you write a book, can you just give me a mention? Please.
He looked quite scared then. He's like, yes, yes. Sorry, yes.
What was the song, by the way?
In the school disco?
Yeah, in the school disco.
Well, of course, you don't necessarily listen to the song. The song that gets everyone dancing was Girls and Boys by Blur in the novel.
Yeah.
And there's a slowing. I can't remember what they're dancing to. I think it's Careless Whisper.
Oh, of course.
Which I think people still slow dance to in 97.
That was me. Yeah. I danced to Careless Whisper at the disco.
Your novel, Us, is being made by the BBC.
That's
into
right.
a four-parter, is that right?
Yeah.
So is that being filmed now?
It is, yeah. Yeah, I should be there, but I'm promoting the book, so I'm skiving off.
I was going to say, because it takes us all over the place, doesn't it? Yeah. So there's going to be some great places to film it.
And they're filming in Paris and Venice and Amsterdam and Barcelona, and I'm going to miss all of it.
Yeah, aww. Because you're just busy with the book tour.
I'm on the book tour, yeah.
Have you got a hand masseuse on the book tour? How do you cope? Do you sign an awful lot of your books?
Before the book comes out, you go to a big warehouse and they wheel in this trolley with 3,000 books on, and you sit there for 4 hours just doing one after another, like a machine.
I did it for my book, Till the Cows Come Home, still available.
That was really subtle.
So you've signed all of those and they all go out. And then is it nice to meet your fans, or have you got some anti-back gel under the desk?
No, I really love it. I've been doing 2 or 3 events a day, and that goes on for a while, and it's great. It's great. I mean, I'm writing is so solitary and lonely, sometimes, and a bit boring. And it's lovely to get out and talk about the books.
And do you know where your books are going? This is a question that always fascinates me, because we'll have some authors will say, absolutely, it's all planned, you know, exactly what's going to happen at the beginning, middle and end, and what the character's going to do. And some, like Ian Rankin, no, they'll often surprise me. You have to, you know, sort of listen to what the characters say and they'll take you on the journey. And as a control freak, I'm like, what? What do you do?
Well, I was a TV writer before I was a novelist. So I used to work on shows like Cold Feet, and you have to deliver a story document, and it has to be very worked out, scene by scene, what everyone's going to say. And you do all of that before you write the fun stuff, the dialogue and the character. And I bring some of that to a novel, really. I mean, the one time I tried to make it up as I went along, I wrote 40,000 words and then abandoned it. And I never want to do that again.
Gosh. So I'm pretty. That's sort of half a book, isn't it?
Yeah. It was a lot of work. So I'm pretty strict with myself now about not knowing not as precisely as I used to know, but I'm pretty sure what's going to happen. I certainly know the ending.
Okay. Yeah. You're a big fan of Shakespeare, aren't you, David? Yeah. I'm glad you said that. now, if, like David, you're inspired by the bard, is this a card I see before me? It is, and it's got some lovely recommendations on it. The Royal Shakespeare, Stratford-upon-Avon. What's happening there, please, at the Royal Shakespeare Company?
So, all through the summer, there's free open-air theatre productions of Romeo and Juliet, which is the play in Sweet Sorrow, Much Ado About Nothing, which is my favourite play, and The Tempest, they're all coming up. There are workshops on stage fighting, stage makeup, how to get bruises and cuts and scars, artificial bruises, cuts and scars.
Otherwise, you can just fall off the stage.
Behind-the-scenes family tours with a chance to try on costumes.
Mm, very nice. And there's a Shakespeare play in your book that the two main characters meet, when he sort of laying a field, isn't he, and minding his own business, and then ends up being dragged into a drama group for love.
Oh, that's right. I fancy this one now.
Yeah.
What should I start with?
This one.
This one?
Yeah. Go out and buy it.
And then I go to one day.
I think so,
second.
Yeah, maybe.
Okay.
Yeah.
You two should swap numbers so you can just talk her through it.
Yes.
Okay, which one
have you
finished?
3 years.
Okay, babe, yeah, no, do this one next.
You David, I'm on page 27.
The Shakespeare Express, love the sound of this, catch the vintage steam train from Birmingham Snow Hill to Stratford-upon-Avon and back in August and September. So you're on this steam train, and then an actual Shakespeare on board pops along all the train carriages reciting sonnets as he goes.
It's really good, though, isn't it? There's so many people that sort of want to get into theatre in any way, shape or form.
It's a really nice way to introduce
it. It's a nice way. Like, I remember doing lessons. I went to a stage school, so we would have maybe 3 hours a week reading Shakespeare. It was something they felt was really strongly that we understood before going and doing other acting classes.
That's sort of what inspired the book, really. I wanted that experience of putting on a play, how intense it is, the friendships, the crushes, the feuds, you know. I wanted to try and write a comedy about that and what it feels like to do that when you're 15, 16 years old.
Very nice. If you want to get on the Shakespeare Express, £35 per person, but if you're under 12, you can go free with your mum and dad. Right, Shakespeare's Rose Theatre is Europe's first ever pop-up Shakespearean theatre. This sounds so gorgeous. You can go see it at Blenheim Palace in Oxfordshire and at Clifford's Tower in York. There's loads of plays on until September. There's a Shakespearean village just outside the theatre as well, with food, should be like a swan leg, no, I don't know, drinks, mead, maybe, and entertainment. If you go to Blenheim, Tickets from £22. If you go to York, it's £12.50. And there, ladies and gentlemen, is a North-South divide. Tom, John, thank you very much. We're going to put another song on our playlist, if you'll do the honours, please.
Sure.
David.
Betty, play my song.
Oh, you stepped up. You stepped up.
That's good. Oh, yes.
Hopefully Sunday morning when I get my heart out and dry over the country road.
Absolutely gorgeous. Lovely choice, Aretha. Thank you. Say a little prayer. Thank you for putting this on the board. You three, I think this is the strongest
day we've
had.
It is a good list.
It's a good Sunday morning.
It really is.
It feels good. Mind you, Ernie, the fastest milkman in the West, is on thanks to Harry Hill, so I can't on your Sunday morning.
We skipped that one.
And why do you love that song so much, David?
Sometimes when you write a book, you need a kind of soundtrack, and with One Day, this was sort of the song I held in my head. It's a really brilliantly written song. It has all these time changes and these strange chords, and it has the most amazing vocal. You know, it's a really extraordinary piece of singing. And yes, it's the kind of mood of this song is what I wanted to put on the page in One Day.
Okay, nice. We'll pop it on the playlist. It'll sound magnificent. David's latest book, Sweet Sorrow, is gorgeous, and it is out now. David Nicholls, everyone.
Thank you very much.
DeVito size break, and then we'll be back in no time with fun and free events near you and book suggestions galore. We shall see you in a flash. That was lovely. Thank you. Still here. We're going for a team bonding piercing session after this. Yay! Ranvir Singh, David Nicholls, and Louise. Woohoo! Now then, Ranvir, if part of your show, Eat, Shop, Save, helps families to save money, and we love to hop aboard a bandwagon on this show. So here's some very fun things to do in summer that are absolutely free, which is exciting. You've got the Edinburgh Fringe for me there, babe.
Yes, I certainly have. You know, have you ever been to Edinburgh Fringe, you guys? You,
yeah. No, I haven't, but I'd love to.
So I took Tashan, my little boy, last year. I was going up there to work, and I wasn't expecting it to be great for kids, but my God, it was absolutely fantastic. So it's on until the 26th of August. Loads of free family fun events to do. There's magic shows, comedy, musical, circus performances, right in the street. And it was just such a lovely atmosphere. It's a beautiful city anyway.
Yeah, it's so really buzzy. There's loads
wonderful.
Of food.
And you know, it's just a nice place. So, obviously, Sean loves Iron Brew because it's the one most sugary drink that he's never allowed to touch. Yeah. So, Mum, we're in Edinburgh. Do you know what I'm going to have? I was like, you're allowed it now.
He's like, Mum, I'm respecting the culture.
That's exactly
of the place
what he was like, well, we are here.
This sounds gorgeous. If you're in Rochdale, the Feel Good Festival, it's a one day festival, Saturday, 10th of August, in Rochdale Town Centre from 11 a.m. There's live music, food and drink, loads of family entertainment, the Family Zone, where there's a cycle-powered carousel. They have got electricity in Rochdale, by the way, before anybody makes any northernist jokes. It's just cycle-powered for the fun of it. Playground of Illusions, inflatable assault course, which are hugely fun, and loads of street performances, loads of lovely food and drink and all that, so get involved with that. And then there's the Hoop app, which I would have loved when my kids were a bit smaller. If you've got tiny, tiny ones, up to the age of 11 years old, it's an app where you pop in your passcode and it's got loads of good stuff like classes, workshop, events and activities in your area. Yeah, it's really good. It's called Hoop, as in hula. Right, thanks very much for that. Let's load up the bookshelves with our guest Literary Obsessions. Everyone's brought us their must-read books. Ranvir, what would you like to add to my shelf, please?
So I'd like to add, of course, all of David.
Of course.
Sure. Just let's make that very clear right now.
All
of those.
Brand.
But also this one, Nine Perfect Strangers. It was just a kind of random buy. I booked a holiday and I just thought I just need something just to take me away from politics, just something completely different, not heavy. And I read this and it was brilliant. So I think that Nicole Kidman has bought the rights to this book and is going to make it into a film.
Yes.
Because it's set in a retreat in Australia, in the outback, but it's got a really dark turn to it. So I can't say too much, but it's actually what I loved about it because I was just feeling really run down. You know, you're having that time in your life, you just feel, oh, just, I'm so tired. And in it, you really identify with why these people are going to this retreat, what it is in their life that is wrong, and they're trying to go in.
You like trying to find the actual retreat.
Yes, I was. I was like, can I go?
Yeah. And obviously, from the same writer as Big Little Lies.
Which I've never seen.
Oh, it's incredible. You've got to catch up with it.
I have.
It's amazing.
I need to do it, yeah.
It's really, really good. Yeah, you've got to catch up with that. What have you got for us, please, David?
Oh, this is one of my favourite writers, Elizabeth Strout, and this is a selection of short stories called Olive Kittredge, set in a small fishing town in North America. Some short stories that are funny, some that are sad, some that are painful, but they all sort of centre around this character of Olive, who's rude and outspoken and cantankerous and an amazing creation. And I think Elizabeth Strout is an extraordinary writer and she gives ordinary lives real depth, and I recommend it very highly.
Lovely. It'll look fine on my bookshelf. Louise?
So I actually went for a book that I love, and it's not a conventional sort of novel. It's called What I Know For Sure by Oprah Winfrey. And the reason I love this book, it's a book that you can just randomly pick up and read any page from. So basically, she's obviously had a very interesting life. Anyone that knows about her life as a little girl, I mean, she has really been through the mill, and she writes about things that she's learnt through her lifetime, and one thing she knows for sure is about backing herself. And I've just sort of over the last couple of years, I don't always get the chance to sit down and engross myself in a novel, and I can find that I can just read three or four pages of this and get a little bit of wisdom. And now I buy it for all of my girlfriends, and my mum actually bought me this. She said, I want you to keep this on you when you need a bit of inspiration.
It's always a sign of a good book when you buy it for your girlfriends, isn't it? Because I brought Catelyn Moran's How to Be a Woman. I bought that for lots of people, and it's nice, isn't it, to pass it on.
She's so full of, she's just done so much with her life, and you know, I just love her messaging within it. So
okay, perfect. Yeah. What a lovely combination of books today. Thank you. You've done very well with the music and the books. Well done, you. Gold stars all round today. Louise, it's time for you to sing again. If you'd like to head on over to the little area. Hoping she slips into a crop top and cargo trousers and her eternal days. She's saying no. She says no chance. If you missed any of the recommendations in today's show, no need to panic and go at the shower curtain with the saccateurs. Simply check out The Sara Cox Show on Facebook, Twitter or Instagram. Now with Let's Go Round Again, it is the brilliant Louise.
Yeah.
gorgeous, over-friendly backslaps to all my guests today. Ranvir Singh, David Nicholls, and, of course, Louise. How good was that? Because two smoocheroonies to you over spending a Sunday morning with us. Next weekend, I'm joined by Alan Titchmarsh, Nina Wadia, and Janet Ellis, plus there's live music from Jade Bird and Feeder. So until then, work hard, play hard, and nap whenever possible. Bye! It's good for you, guys.